For nearly 2,000 years, the Roman Catholic Church was recognized by its faithful as the one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. A worldwide church, bound together not only by a common rite of Mass said in a common language, but by shared beliefs, honored traditions, and by the proclamations of infallible dogma. Today, that church is a house divided against itself, split between traditionalists and modernists, between the sanctity of the old and the liberalism of the new. Once, the magnificent spires of Catholic churches around the world reached like arms outstretched to heaven, proudly proclaiming the majesty of Christ the King. And holy and timeless statuary and painting stood in silent tribute to that same Christ and his glorious Virgin Mother, while solemn chants or soaring hymns of praise resounded in tribute to the Triune God. But the 20th century has seen a breakthrough of the smoldering forces of liberal reform. Pope John XXIII, a well-known modernist, voiced his desire to let a little fresh air into the church. So, in 1962, he symbolically opened the windows by convening the Second Vatican Council. As if in some Satan-inspired replay of the 16th century Protestant Revolution, the council wasted no time in flirting with many of the same errors committed by such heretics as Luther, Cranmer, Zwingli, Calvin, and others, whose influence had once swept across Europe and beyond. Council modernists even included those who had previously attacked the fundamental doctrines of the church, who had called into question Christ's divinity, as well as the perpetual virginity of his Blessed Mother. Plus, they had challenged the truth of original sin, hell, and transubstantiation. And their influence was manifested in Vatican II proclamations that eased the way for eventually altering the rites of all the sacraments. Demands for church reform sounded throughout St. Peter's, echoing the demands of Martin Luther some 400 years earlier. And even before the end of the council's final session, changes had crept into the Mass. Vatican II came to a close in December of 1965. Now, the liberal forces that had been warned against by previous popes were released in all their misguided fury. The genie of modernism was out of the bottle at last.
People, give out communion. Everybody's a minister of the Eucharist, my brothers and sisters. Do you know why we change that? Why change that?
And the spirit of the council would lead to the birth of the Novus Ordo, the new order of the Mass, and in effect, to the beginning of a new church. Even Paul VI, ever a proponent of Vatican II, would later acknowledge that clouds, storms, and darkness had followed the council, and the smoke of Satan had entered the church. But not even he could foresee the destruction and desecration to come. One obvious aspect of the Vatican II revolution is the change in church architecture. In the past 30-some years, many magnificent old structures have been modified or destroyed. And following Vatican II, the hierarchy directed that great churches, those that are also works of art, should no longer be built because they are an affront to the poor. So, with rare exceptions, the construction of new, magnificent structures dedicated to the honor of God are discouraged. And Judas's admonition to Mary Magdalene that money not be wasted on the service of our Lord is repeated in the socially correct sensitivity that inspires the design of so many of today's Catholic churches. Most of the new structures are not only aesthetically bankrupt, they occasionally invite comparison to pagan shrines. And others are no longer called churches, but communities. Yet while church exteriors have supposedly become less offensive to the poor, their interiors look more like barren auditoriums or theaters, even New Age temples, rather than Catholic places of worship. At the same time, older, once sacred church interiors have been transformed into mere shells of their former grace and solemnity. Traditional and holy furnishings that for generations had identified them as uniquely Catholic have been doomed. In what can be likened to the destruction and desecration wrought by the French Revolution's Reign of Terror, the years following Vatican II, have seen the virtual gutting and ransacking of Catholic churches throughout the world. Michael Matt, editor of The Remnant, describes his own chilling memories of a similar experience from his childhood.
It is also the church that when the changes came about, the high altar, they took a chainsaw or whatever type of saw cuts marble, hacked it up, and to this day, if any of you ever come to visit The Remnant, I can take you to the place, to this parking lot again, where the church where I was baptized, and show you where pieces of the high altar are being used as curbstones in the parking lot. Now this is...
In imitation of an heretical practice initiated in the 16th century, marble altars have been replaced by tables, even in what had once been the most Catholic of all Catholic churches. Now they are made of anything from wood to plastic. And without so much as an altar stone, they lack even the sacredness that was found in the makeshift battlefront altars of World War II. Yet these butcher blocks seem perfectly suited for what in the Novus Ordo Church has become a communal meal, rather than the unbloody sacrifice mandated by Christ. Perhaps Luther has triumphed after all in the modern church. And our Lord himself has been relegated to a position of obscurity. Not only has his image been stripped from crosses in church after church, if indeed there are any crosses left, but tabernacles containing the Blessed Sacrament, along with sanctuary lamps, have been removed from the central place of honor on the altar and consigned to insignificant alcoves, or shunted off to different rooms altogether. All this in spite of a 1957 decree by the Sacred Congregation of Rites categorically forbidding that tabernacles be situated outside the altar. In St. John chapter 20, verse 2, Mary Magdalene lamented, "They have taken the Lord, and we do not know where they have laid him." Tragically, her words live again today. Moreover, images of our Blessed Mother, once prominent features of every Catholic church in the world, have, in all too many cases, joined the statues of saints and angels that are now so conspicuously absent. Indeed, if statuary or art can still be found, it is often grotesque or blasphemous, such as a feminist depiction of the Last Supper, a monstrance made from a wine bottle, or a modernist representation of the Blessed Mother that is more likely to inspire diabolical thoughts than sacred ones. Crucifixes have become abstract images or have been replaced by a risen Christ. And even the bare Protestant-like crosses have in many cases been replaced by plus signs. The list of traditional church fixtures that have fallen victim to modernism is as long as it is sad. Kneelers and altar rails are no longer built in new churches and have been removed from many old ones. Side altars have all but vanished. And stained glass windows, which once depicted church history and the lives of the saints, have been displaced by useless mosaics signifying nothing. So much for the spirit of Vatican II. Once, Catholic churches were solemn places of worship, where silence and dignity were maintained out of reverence for the actual presence of Christ. Today, they're more often social gathering places, filled with irreverent noise and hubbub that befits a movie theater or sports arena. And in many cases, reverent contemplation or prayer has been replaced by interpretive dancing. Just as modesty in dress fell victim to the excesses of the 60s, today women's head coverings and men's conservative clothing have given way to attire that is better suited for backyard barbecues, if even there. Moreover, these external signs of disrespect are not limited to the laity. In the post-conciliar church, the clergy seem to want to dress like laymen in public and act as entertainers during Mass. And not only are the ideas of heaven, hell, and purgatory being debated anew, even the concept of limbo is reinterpreted in the sanctuary. And in many parishes, the role of the priest has become less one of spiritual leader and more one of social worker, or that of an activist, who seems more concerned with so-called political correctness than saving immortal souls. Nuns, as well, have all but abandoned their traditional habits. John Benari, editor of Catholic Family News, viewed these changes from a front row seat in Catholic schools.
When I was in first grade, all we saw of Sister Joan Labouré was her hands and her face. And by the time I got to eighth grade, I knew that Sister Kevin Leonard had red hair and varicose veins.
Even some princes of the church have adopted vestments intended as political or social statements, rather than designations of their holy positions. While others sport pagan-inspired costumes in the name of diversity and enculturation. Pope Paul VI set the precedent for change when in 1964 he surrendered his papal ring and crucifix to the Buddhist U Thant, then Secretary General of the United Nations. And while addressing that one world body, the Pope said, "The peoples of the earth turn to the United Nations as the last hope of concord and peace." A curious statement for the Vicar of Christ. The new papal crucifix, subsequently adopted by Paul VI and carried by succeeding popes, features a distorted, bent cross and a gangly, spread-legged Christ, an image attributed to Satanists of the 5th century. And the papal tiara, its three tiers representing the Holy Trinity, has been abandoned. Paul VI never wore it again after his investiture, choosing a bishop's mitre instead, and proclaimed in 1975 that no future pontiff was required to wear the crown. Thus, his successor, John Paul I, chose not to be crowned pope and declined a traditional coronation. He opted instead for a ceremony that he helped compose and was the first pope never to wear the crown, which had always symbolized leadership of the universal Catholic Church. John Paul II followed his lead. But ecclesiastical dress, or lack of it, is not the only thing in the new church that shocks the senses. For centuries, solemn, hauntingly beautiful Gregorian chants were considered the official music of the church. And as time went on, some of the most magnificent music ever composed by the great masters was written for use during the celebration of the Mass. And the influence of such music has gone far beyond its religious origins. Dr. David Allen White, professor of English at the U.S. Naval Academy and a classical music scholar, had this to say.
Well, that Mass gave us Western music. The oldest Western music we have written down is Gregorian chant. And if you take a music history course, you're going to begin with chant and go through church music, and it won't be secularized till much later. But when it is, you're still going to have Mozart writing masses and Haydn writing masses. And you're going to even have someone who was just crotchety and cranky and probably had a good reason to be because of his deafness. Beethoven, who wrestled with God his whole life, still writing the great Missa Solemnis and seeing a priest on his deathbed. I mean, that is the tradition of music.
These classical masterpieces remain examples of some of man's most noble and uplifting creations, a cultural as well as a religious legacy. And what is the legacy of post-Vatican II music? But there are changes in the modern church beyond new sights and sounds, changes that are less conspicuous, but far more important. Undoubtedly influenced by the presence of the large contingent of non-Catholic observers at the Council, reforms mandated by Vatican II's Constitution of the Liturgy led ultimately to sweeping revisions in the rites of the seven sacraments. During the reign of Pope Paul VI alone, they all underwent major change. A prime illustration is the sacrament of baptism. The new rite, seen here during a Novus Ordo Mass and performed by a deacon while the priest looks on, bears a striking similarity to Luther's revised order of baptism dating from 1526. The traditional Catholic rite incorporates such things as exorcism by breathing on the candidate, saying the required prayers, the giving of salt, and anointings before and after baptism. All elements that were eliminated by Luther and that have been eliminated in the modern church. So that now it seems the baptismal ceremony is little more than an initiation into the Christian community, rather than redemption from original sin. The rite of the sacrament of penance has also undergone extraordinary change. In 1977, a new rite of reconciliation was decreed for the Universal Church, and the term confession slipped into the dusty realm of historical oddity. But confession is one of the things that sets Catholics apart from Protestants and other religions and sects. It is a solemn obligation in which penitents confess their sins, declare sincere contrition, vow to amend their lives, ask forgiveness, and receive absolution from their priest. In many Novus Ordo churches, confessionals have been removed or have become reconciliation rooms in which priest and penitent have a discussion. This too echoes Martin Luther's view that penance was simply a recognition of past errors, a return to peace of mind, without true contrition for having offended God. And traditional one-priest, one-penitent confessions have in many cases given way to rites of general absolution, which are often performed illegally, in direct violation of canon law, or contrary to the Holy Father's wishes, while for the most part, the few traditional confessionals that remain stand empty. As for the rite of the sacrament of confirmation, a quote from Pope Paul VI effectively summarizes the Vatican II changes. He said, in part, that only the initial blessing over all the confirmands has been retained. This was in spite of the fact that most theologians maintain that essential matter, the required actions for the sacrament, consists of the imposition of hands and the anointing with holy chrism. Moreover, the old form or words of confirmation, as specified by the Dogmatic Council of Trent, signifies that the bishop has imposed the sacrament. I sign you with the sign of the cross and confirm you with the chrism of salvation. But the new words, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, resemble nothing more than a simple blessing, one that has even been imparted in a big league baseball park while the congregation of fans munched on hot dogs and hymns were sung to the tune of Take Me Out to the Ball Game. A travesty on the sacrament that calls the recipient to be a soldier of Christ, as was embodied by the glorious Saint Joan of Arc. The rite of the sacrament of matrimony, however, has changed little following Vatican II in regard to the marriage ceremony itself, except for the increase in mixed marriages where a priest, with or without his non-Catholic counterpart, administers the rite to both parties, believer and heretic alike. Christ elevated matrimony from a simple contract to the dignity of a sacrament, thereby revoking Old Testament law and making a valid marriage indissoluble, King Henry VIII and his six wives notwithstanding. But problems with Catholic marriages today are more likely to concern the ease with which the sacred vows are abandoned with the church's blessing. In St. Luke chapter 16, verse 18, Christ tells us that everyone who puts away his wife and marries another commits adultery. And prior to Vatican II, the church regarded divorce with remarriage a mortal sin, attaching to it the penalty of excommunication. But that ruling was rescinded by the American Catholic bishops in 1977. So now they apologize to the divorced and remarried.
To those who have not been allowed to receive the sacraments of the Church, including the divorced and remarried, and to those who have not been shown adequate hospitality, we ask forgiveness.
And annulment has become the new marriage escape clause. From 1952 to 1956, only 392 were granted by the Church worldwide. But in 1968, following Vatican II, there were 450 annulments in the United States alone. And by 1997, the yearly worldwide number had exploded to more than 73,000. Curiously, the new church insists on divorce prior to granting an annulment. One example, unusual even by modernist standards, involved a father of three who divorced after 24 years of marriage, was granted an annulment, and subsequently became a priest. But even such an incident pales in light of changes that occurred in the rite of the Sacrament of Holy Orders. Vatican II officially decreed that both the ceremonies and texts of the ordination rite are to be revised, and revised they were, in spite of Pope Pius XII's declaration in Sacramentum Ordinis that no one is allowed to infringe upon this rite. Where there had once been eight steps involved in priestly ordination, guidelines approved by Paul VI in 1968 saw this number reduced to just two, although such changes had been forbidden by the Council of Trent. In the traditional ordination rite, the bishop instructs the candidate that the priest's office is to offer sacrifice, to bless, to guide, to preach, and to baptize. Today, however, the ordinand is simply consecrated to celebrate the liturgy. But of far greater significance is the removal of certain essential prayers. Priests are no longer specifically granted the power to change bread and wine into Christ's body and blood, nor are they explicitly ordained to forgive sins. These omissions closely parallel the removal of numerous ordination prayers by the 16th century Protestant reformers, which, like the Novus Ordo rite, reduced the priest to merely a presider.
I'm the presider in your dissembling.
So, again, the ghosts of Luther and Cranmer can be seen swirling in the residual mists of the Second Vatican Council. And because of these questionable changes, concerned scholars and theologians have raised serious doubts as to the validity of the new ordination rite and the clergy thus invested. Another deplorable change in the rites of the sacraments deals with extreme unction, commonly referred to as the last rites, so named because in most cases it is the final sacrament of the recipient's life. Quite literally, the last chance to receive special graces before facing God's judgment. And it is administered by a priest whose job and intent is the concern for the salvation of souls. The rite that replaced it became mandatory in 1972 and is called anointing of the sick. Unlike extreme unction, the new rite concerns itself more with comforting and healing the body than with saving the soul. The words, "May the Lord forgive you whatever sins you have committed," have been changed to, "May the Lord in his love and mercy help you with the grace of the Holy Spirit." Gone is the all-important plea for God's pardon. Moreover, the new rite is encouraged as a communal celebration, rather than a personal interaction between priest and recipient. As such, it has often become simply a general or group blessing for senior citizens or the sick. And now dying classes explain how easy it is to get to heaven. But there is a more important, more tragic, more painful example of what we have lost in the split between traditionalists and modernists. And it goes to the very heart and soul of our faith. In the sacrament of the Holy Eucharist, the holy sacrifice of the Mass. The traditional Latin Mass has been carefully handed down through the ages, the truth of our Lord as received by the apostles. To maintain this truth, Pope St. Pius V codified and infallibly canonized the Mass for all time and in perpetuity, in quo primum. This authoritative 1570 papal bull ends with the warning, "Should anyone presume to tamper with this, let him know that he shall incur the wrath of Almighty God and his holy apostles Peter and Paul." The full text of the proclamation appeared in the front of every altar missal from then on and was ratified by a succession of some 35 popes through John the 23rd. But Pope Paul VI, ignoring St. Pius V's warning, set up a commission to institute the reforms mandated by Vatican II, many of which reflected the powerful influence of the non-Catholic observers who attended the council. Then, in 1969, Paul VI imposed a new rite of Mass on the Catholic world.
In particular, particularly because of the journalist Jean Guitton, who was a close friend and confidant of Paul VI. Here's what he said in a recent radio interview. I guess it was around 1995. He said, the intention of Paul VI, personal friend of Paul VI talking, the intention of Paul VI was to reform the Catholic liturgy in such a way that it should almost coincide with the Protestant liturgy. But what is curious is that Paul VI did that to get as close as possible to the Protestants' Lord's Supper. There was with Paul VI an ecumenical intention to remove, or at least to correct, or at least to relax what was too Catholic in the traditional sense in the Mass. And I repeat, to get the Catholic Mass closer to the Calvinist Mass, close quote. Well, just tell a Calvinist that he's going to Mass.
The new order of the Mass, or Novus Ordo, was marked by its obvious concessions to ecumenism. Hardly surprising in light of the fact that it was mainly written by Archbishop Annibale Bonini, a known Freemason, with the help of 6 Protestant ministers. At first, the new rite of Mass didn't seem that different, just a gradual shift away from Latin. Then, missalettes in English, handshakes and the sign of peace, a Protestant phrase added to the Lord's Prayer. But the changes were as relentless as they were insidious, and we have awakened to find we have lost many essential points of Catholic doctrine, such as recognition of the real presence of our Lord on the altar. Now, there's a question of the proper matter for the Holy Eucharist itself, the proper ingredients, if you will. The Church has always taught that the bread should be unleavened and made with wheat flour and natural water, and the wine must be the product of ripened grapes. When these elements have been consecrated, they become the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus Christ, the perfect sacrificial victim, the perfect sacrifice offered to God for our salvation. And what constitutes an acceptable sacrifice was established in the Old Testament. Jerry Matitix, a leading Catholic apologist and president of Biblical Foundations International, explains.
In the scripture, God always asked people to give him their very best. In the Old Testament, the Israelites were called to give God a lamb without blemish. And they could not give him a lamb that was blind or lame or halt or undersized like me. You know, you had to give God your most robust, your most muscular, your most, the best lamb.
As recorded in Genesis, Abel offered God the firstlings of his flock. In other words, his very best animals, to be, as nearly as possible, a perfect sacrifice. And this was pleasing to God and was accepted. But Cain offered fruits of the earth, and God had no respect for these lesser gifts, gifts that in the new church are called fruit of the vine and work of human hands, a truly inferior sacrifice, as Cain's was inferior.
As a result, if we offer God the new Mass, common sense tells us we're offering him something less noble, less mature, less sublime, less elevated, less exalted, less God-glorifying, less majestic, less transcendent than if we offer him the old.
And how much more inferior are the so-called sacrifices of Novus Ordo churches, in which cookies or some other bakery products are substituted for wheaten bread, and where fruit juice or a soft drink takes the place of wine, and where the consecrated blood of our Lord is set aside like dirty glasses after a party. Even more damning, however, are the revisions in the form of the Holy Eucharist, the words, words that Christ himself used during the consecration. They've been changed so drastically in the new Eucharistic prayers that transubstantiation, the changing of bread and wine into the body and blood of Christ, becomes questionable. Christ's statement that his blood shall be shed for you and for many has been revised to for you and for all. The difference between the words all and many is obvious, and this change introduced a concept of all-inclusive salvation that clearly the Lord never intended. Interestingly, the other approved Catholic rites and even the Episcopal Church retain the word many in their Eucharistic prayers. Only Martin Luther's namesake church, along with the new Catholic Church, has changed many to all. Further, the words the mystery of faith, which acknowledge the mystery of transubstantiation, have been deleted from the consecration of the wine. According to sacred tradition, these were Christ's words, affirmed by popes through the ages, and preserved for all time in quo prima. But in Paul VI's new Mass, these words refer to the Protestant-friendly declaration that Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. More a statement of the obvious than an article of faith, and certainly not much of a mystery. Gone, too, from the Mass are the prayers at the foot of the altar, most of the offertory, and the Leonine prayers, some 35 in all, deleted along with numerous references, symbols, and gestures that accompanied them. And gone is the last gospel. In its place, one would not be surprised today to hear the announcement that Father has left the building. Also missing from the new church is the notion that only the consecrated fingers of a priest should come in contact with the sacred body of our Lord. No less an authority than St. Thomas Aquinas, the one angelic doctor of the church, has declared that, out of reverence for this sacrament, only consecrated hands should touch it. Moreover, the Council of Trent emphasized that even a priest's fingers that have touched the consecrated body of Christ should touch nothing else, not even the sacred chalice, until they have been cleansed in sacramental water and wine. So it's clear that points of essential doctrine concerning the Mass, like the real presence, the reality of a true sacrifice, and the power of the priest, have become subjects for question. Points of doctrine that, in the precision of the ancient Mass, are affirmed without the slightest doubt. As for external trappings of the Mass, some of the more blatant changes include the use of female servers, although initially forbidden by the Holy Father, and the substitution of a table for an altar, removal of the crucifix, the priest facing the people, the Eucharist offered under both species, communion in the hand, and Eucharistic ministers. This latter abomination is permitted in the new church in spite of authoritative judgment to the contrary. Again, the words of St. Thomas. As the consecrating of Christ's body belongs to the priest, so likewise does the dispensing belong to him. These sacrileges are further manifestations of the new church's sad loss of respect for the real presence of our Lord in the Holy Eucharist. In many cases, hosts are treated like meaningless snacks to be passed out by the irreverent handful. Perhaps this is a reflection of data showing that up to 70% of modern priests do not believe in transubstantiation. Is it any wonder, then, that most of today's Novus Ordo churches are barely distinguishable, if at all, from their Protestant counterparts? Does this Catholic church look any different from this Protestant one? Listen to this rendition of the Our Father. Is there any substantial difference between it and the Protestant version? Does any doubt remain that the modern Catholic Church has been effectively Protestantized, poisoned by Protestant and modernist errors which are attacking it from within? Yet it doesn't stop there. Benediction, the Rosary, Novenas, and other devotionals have vanished. And in keeping with the Vatican II decree on ecumenism, interfaith services with non-Catholics are now common. Not to win converts to Catholicism, but to put all religions on the same level. Always condemned by the traditional church, such commingling is now, in the words of the decree itself, to be encouraged. This has progressed to the point where even pagan religions are honored and endorsed. But there are no degrees of truth, and there can be only one true church, the one founded by Jesus Christ. To deny that, to put all religions on an equal footing, is to deny the very essence of the Catholic faith. This is not to demean those who follow man-made, man-centered religions, the religions of Luther, Calvin, Wesley, Henry VIII, and others, but to show them the way and the truth, to invite them in, to welcome them. That's why, at the time of the First Vatican Council, Pope Pius IX sent a letter to the Orthodox and Protestants, inviting them to, quote, return to the Catholic Church. Why? Because he truly loved them and wanted to save their souls from hell. Christ said, "And other sheep I have that are not of this fold. Them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. Still, there are Catholics who ask, why should we worry about a few changes? Wasn't Vatican II good for growth in the church? Consider these shocking statistics. From 1965 to 1998, aided by immigration, the Catholic population of the U.S. increased from 45 million to 60 million. But during the same time, the total number of seminarians dropped from roughly 45,000 to about 4,500, while the number of seminaries went from nearly 600 to fewer than 200, and priestly ordinations fell by nearly half. And though the number of parishes grew by 2,000, those without a resident priest mushroomed by 400%. Some dioceses have even resorted to using billboard advertising to promote vocations. Religious sisters, too, have seen their ranks decimated, from nearly 180,000 to just about half that number today. And sadly, a 1995 study shows that only about 25% of Catholics attend Mass on a regular basis. So much for Vatican II growth. Yet there are those who persist in asking, isn't the Mass still the Mass? Isn't it still the Catholic Church? Tragically, the answer is no. And it is only by reviewing these changes in their entirety that the magnitude of what we have lost becomes apparent. It is a new church, indeed a new religion. How else could one explain things like hula masses, dancing in the sanctuary, clown masses? And for those Catholics who maintain that such abuses don't happen in their parish, consider this. Even where external changes are minimal, it is not things like architecture and music that are at the crux of the problem. A vital concern must be what has happened to the sacraments. There, changes are less obvious but are universally dangerous and have raised serious, legitimate questions of validity. So it's not just nostalgia for the old days or for a Mass in Latin that demands a return to traditional Catholicism. It's because even a reasonable doubt as to the validity of any sacrament is sufficient cause to avoid it. In fact, by canon law, it is a Catholic's obligation to do so. Any other course of action creates a grave danger to one's faith and ultimate salvation. Yet for those who hesitate to return to the old Mass because they fear it would be disobedient, they need look no further than Quo Primum again. St. Pius V decreed that the Roman Rite Missal may be used freely and lawfully, and by virtue of our apostolic office. And he added, we grant and permit this forever. Moreover, in 1995, Alphonse Cardinal Stickler proclaimed that even the Pope can't forbid a Mass that has not only been used for centuries, but has been the Mass of thousands and thousands of saints and faithful. And His Eminence pointed out that a 9-cardinal papal commission appointed by John Paul II unanimously agreed that no bishop may forbid a Catholic priest from saying the Tridentine Mass. Plus, he confirmed that the 9 cardinals had determined that the traditional Latin Mass has never been officially forbidden. Therefore, it is vital to bear in mind the warning of Pope St. Felix III. Not to oppose error is to approve it, and not to defend truth is to suppress it. And indeed, to neglect to confound evil men when we can do it is no less a sin than to encourage them. So not only are we free to return to the traditional church, we are obliged to do just that. Because now we've seen the disastrous changes in the new church. And, more importantly, we must recognize the dreadful loss those changes have caused to the true Catholic faith. Fortunately, there is a road to restoration. Jesus promised that His church would last forever. So it's important to maintain hope, to take heart in the fact that there is today a vital and faithful remnant of that true church. The signs are everywhere. For instance, traditional Catholic periodicals and publications are flourishing. They represent a powerful voice for the restoration and preservation of traditional Catholicism. And more lay gatherings of traditionalists are springing up around the country and the world. Each year, increasing numbers of traditional Catholics participate in the time-honored custom of penitential walks. From the centuries-old Chartres pilgrimage in France, to the smaller but no less fervent pilgrimages springing up in the United States. And each one is climaxed with a celebration of the Tridentine Mass.
Continuing the tradition of the old pilgrimage, hundreds of Catholics gather in downtown Phoenix for a spiritual walk. This is the second annual Spirit of Charters pilgrimage. Catholics from all over the valley came out to support today's event. They sang songs and prayed while holding religious banners. Some Catholics say today's walk helped them obtain grace and strengthen their faith.
And the surge of lay involvement is evident in the proliferation of places of traditional Catholic worship, though some of them may be less than traditional in appearance. Latin masses are available all across the country, and everything from independent chapels to Society of St. Pius X churches to the back porches of people's homes. Some are even held in rented hotel rooms.
We're holed up here in this little catacomb, this hotel, which is what it is, it's a modern catacomb, trying to eke out and trying to figure out how we're going to make it through this. Because even within the church, we don't have a safe haven anymore.
Traditional masses can also be found in mortuary chapels and wedding chapels, and occasionally, through dire necessity, in borrowed Protestant churches. This particular type of ecumenism, however, has not caught on with the modern Catholic hierarchy. And traditional masses are said in elegant private homes, where perhaps a piano with the requisite sacred furnishings must serve as an altar, while still others are held in more modest surroundings, which sometimes means you have to bring your own kneeler. Thanks to a directory published by Father M. E. Morrison, the locations of traditional chapels around the country are readily available. And like Catholic churches of old, they all offer the unchanging and unchangeable, solemn and sacred Mass of all time, the traditional Latin Mass. So it's clear the fight has been joined. Now each of us must strive to alleviate our Lord's suffering as he is persecuted anew, to stand by him as he's condemned again, this time by the modern abuses to his church. We must help him bear the burden of this new cross that has been placed on his shoulders, the cross of disrespect, indifference, and sacrilege. By our allegiance and faith, we must help him rise when he stumbles under the weight of the unholy and the profane, and help to relieve the sorrow of his Blessed Mother, increasingly ignored by the modernists as she sees her son and his church suffer this new passion. Plus, we are called to help restore her to her rightful place at his side. And we must be new Cyrenians, who, by our continued devotion to the true Catholic Church, help lift Christ's modern burden. Or new Veronicas, who, by spreading the traditional faith, wipe the blood and tears of sadness from his magnificent face. Like the women of Jerusalem, we too may weep for our children as the Lord commanded. But then we must guide them, lest they blindly follow the blind. And no matter how many times our beleaguered church stumbles under the weight of the liberal onslaught, as Jesus stumbled under the cross, we must help her to her feet as we would our beloved Savior himself. Even when she is stripped of her dignity, as he was stripped of his garments, we must maintain the struggle for the truth. And with the pain of the nails and the agony of the cross, replaced by hurt and humiliation caused by those who no longer honor his name or respect his precious body and blood, we must work to restore his glory and that of his church. Though Christ has once more been taken down from the cross in Catholic churches throughout the world, and his consecrated body hidden away in obscure sepulchres, he will be resurrected as before. Resurrected through the love and the faith of those who, by their dedication to his Sacred Heart and to the Immaculate Heart of his Blessed Mother, will restore Christ's one true and eternal church, confirming our unshakable belief in the unassailable truth that neither he nor it will ever perish.